If you are like me and end up prototyping on a breadboard where your components end up being loose and making it very difficult to troubleshoot, take your projects or your prototyping to the next level by going to PCBWay and getting a proper PCB manufactured for your prototyping or your next project. Simply head over to the PCBWay website and click on Instant Quote, and there you can provide the specifications and the requirements for your project and simply place your order. Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this T4D. So in this T4D, I'm going to mainly talk about progress on my high accuracy quartz or my high accuracy clock project or atomic clock. It is ticking on the side here, so I hope the microphone's not picking up too much of that. I will stop it in a moment. And then we'll also have a quick update on the college power supply. I'll tell you where I've got to there. But let's just first, for one, talk about, well, I know these T4Ds, I just want to highlight. I know some people always ask, what is a T4D? And just so that you understand the format and don't get frustrated because it's not exactly structured or here to teach you something, it's a tip or thought for the day. And I set these up so that I don't have to necessarily have anything hectically prepared. I can just have a bit more relaxed chit chat. If that's not for you and chit chat and rambling kind of drives you insane, you want a video that's hardened to the point, these aren't for you. But anyway, if you are gonna stick around, heavens, 2 months since my last T4D, and isn't it crazy what can happen in the space of 2 months in terms of what's happening around the world at the moment? I hope folks are managing to keep sane and safe during these times. It's one thing obviously staying healthy, listening to the right advice and being sensible. There's lots of crazy information going around at the moment, say no more. But besides staying safe, it's also about keeping sane, having a purpose each day and trying to keep yourself busy, especially if you can't go out to work and if you're locked in at home. And I hope you're managing to do that. So the one thing we are going to be talking about, and I just want to highlight a few things that just kind of, that sometimes irk me, and I just want to express a point of view on, is we're going to take a look at this clock project of mine. I've got it to a point where I'm really chuffed. I've taken 2 days out of this week, and I'll also explain about the challenges of time and doing videos. And I've got to a point where it's working really well. I've got it to drive an analog clock, one exactly like this on the bench. We'll take a look at this one before we go and have a look at what's ticking on the side here. But I've certainly had to go down a road of discovery and making mistakes and backing up from those mistakes and learning why things weren't working and trying to get things together. And I just want to highlight that sometimes it's very easy for those of you sitting perhaps on a pedestal and not actually doing something, or maybe you've done this before and you know how it should hang together and you go, oh no, that's wrong, you mustn't do that, you've got to do this. And I just want to highlight that, you know, sometimes there's a place for telling someone that they're doing something wrong if they're going to potentially harm themselves or someone around them, or perhaps damage something that's really valuable or expensive. Then there's a place to go, whoop, be careful. There are consequences to what you're doing. And I know I've certainly done videos in the past where I've done certain things where I've needed that little finger wagging, Martin, be careful because this could be the consequence and something might not quite have been safe. And certainly I then need to pause, look at that advice, and take a step back. But sometimes if someone's doing something on a project where the consequence of doing something wrong or going down the wrong path is not catastrophic, don't say no, you're doing that wrong. And I say that not to do that to me. I've grown a skin doing what I do, doing these videos. But often I think if you are talking to someone who's just out starting to learn and tell them, no, you don't know what you're doing, that's wrong, do this, you can often kill someone's inspiration and creativity very soon, and they just don't want to try something or go down a path in the fear of making a mistake and being ridiculed for it. And that was one of the reasons I started doing some of my videos and tutorials, because I just found there's so many people out there going, eh, you're doing that wrong. I say that because I saw it in some of the past comments. And I thought, if I had to not do these things and go down these paths and learn, I would be far poorer for it. And I just say, please, those of you who have the experience perhaps and you can go, oh, perhaps that's not the right, rather say perhaps that's not the right way of doing it. This might happen, perhaps try it. And if you need a help afterwards, give this a try. But don't say, you're wrong. Don't do that. Right, my little rant out the way. Let's talk about timing or what's happened in terms of my time and sometimes how I have to juggle things to get videos out. Last week I was hoping to do a video on an electronics educational toy, if you like, or a kit which could teach you electronics. I received it from South Africa and I spent a couple of days evaluating it, hoping to then do that video last week. But I came across a few things that I was just a little concerned about that I wanted to clarify or clear up before I did a video with the folks in South Africa. I emailed them and they've not come back to me. So I don't know whether they've somehow taken offense because I've said, hang on, perhaps this needs to be corrected. But there goes 2 days out of the window, or several days out of the window in preparation. And then I have to juggle and go, okay, what am I gonna do next? So that's unfortunately why sometimes you might not get a video in 1 week, but then two in another week. I just have to juggle my time. And like this week, one of my biggest frustrations with what I do is I obviously, for one, because of sponsorship, and two, trying to earn some income from my videos, and also consistency and trying to, not that I'm overly trying to appease my audience or my sponsor for that matter, I try and get a video out once per week. But then I'm faced with the fact that sometimes I cannot give a project my undivided attention. I cannot spend a full day, a full 2 days or 3 days trying to get it to a certain point and troubleshoot, and then still find that I've spent that time and I'm not ready to post a video. So I have to kind of juggle where I spend my time. Like this week I said, okay, forget it. I'm just gonna put my undivided attention in trying to get this project to the next stage. I knew it was potentially challenging. Fortunately, it worked out, but there were several challenges along the way, which I'm going to go into and talk about, where I made some some of the decisions I made perhaps weren't the best. And even though I've got a working, what I consider a good working prototype right now, I know there are definitely improvements I can make to this. So yeah, just bear that in mind. Like for instance, the college power supply, I know, and I'll give you some honest information here, and this is sometimes the challenge with working with, let's say, a sponsor, is that I know they are very keen for me to get to a point where I'm going to produce a PCB and I can go and get a PCB because that's their business, and I can show their PCB and it's specific to a project that I'm doing. But I haven't been ready to do that. That kind of work also needs my undivided attention, as you'll realize when I talk about where we've got to with this. And I know also that the sponsor of my videos would like me to go to them when I'm ready, and then they'll help me with the process of getting the PCB. But I don't want that. I don't want them to know that I'm going to get a PCB, because I want to see how well the process works and how well it works for me and the quality of the PCB that I get back. And I also know that my sponsor will, at the end of each month, look at all my videos to make sure everything's hunky-dory. They don't get to review my videos before they go out. But at the end of the month, I go, here we go, these are all the videos I produced. And they'll see me doing this. But I'm going to try and sneak in my files up to their website. I'm gonna do a video of that so you can see the process and get that board back without directly going through them, so that I can understand how well their process works and then what we get back. Because I'm looking forward to that. I know they produce good boards. I've seen their boards. I've seen other people talk about their PCBs.
But I want to go through that process myself, and then we'll have a prototype, which will be far better. And as you'll see from the advertising, or how I've changed the video clip at the start of these videos now, there's a big difference from the challenges of working on a breadboard and even a strip board or something like that, to getting your prototype on an actual PCB where things aren't loose and rolling about, and you're getting far closer to that stage where hopefully it can work for you. And that's hopefully where we are. So next, I tell you what we're going to do. We're first going to look at this clock project, because it is ticking on the side here and quite annoying, and that's part of the challenge. And then I'll give you an update on the college power supply.
Right then, so let's talk about this process of me wanting to take this where I can actually drive an analog clock versus just having a digital display from an Arduino. I do enjoy analog clocks, so that was my whole reasoning. I wanted both a digital display for the wealth of information you could potentially have on there. You can have obviously the time, you could have the date, I could have my calibration stuff on there, I could have a setting that shows whether I've got daylight savings set on there. But I do like telling time and looking at an analog face, and particularly it's far easier if your eyesight is starting to age. Looking at a digital display versus hands on a big face like this, this is far easier. Now, I saw another project where a guy had produced a clock which was basically kept accurate from the time signal. So he set up an Arduino which received a time signal. He had loads of lovely fancy data which showed when it had updated and how accurate it was, which is obviously slightly different from my project because I want a standalone accurate clock. But he had this mechanical clock, and I saw this late in the day, and I thought, let me go and search for a larger mechanical clock. And that night I went home and I found, fortunately, a pair of these clocks, not from the same purchaser. One was in better condition. This is the one that's in better condition, and at not such a big price. I think I paid $30 for the one, and I think $45 for the other. I've seen some of these going for near $100 for parts, so I consider myself fortunate in what I found. And as it turned out, when I went back the next day after I ordered these off eBay, it was the same mechanism as this German gentleman had done in his project. Although, be it, you can get these in different formats. This acrylic, sandwiched acrylic, is just one format you can get this Seiko movement. And if you look there, you can just see on the gold over there, it says Seiko Quartz. But you'll find that this has been copied or replicated by other clock makers. And so you get a very similar clock mechanism that you can buy off Amazon like this. You get them in different sizes. You can see this is a different size to that one. So if you want a project where you can just, let's say, make a nice piece of woodwork or something else and slot this in and have an analog quartz clock, you can do that as well. Now, I bought several of these because I realized there was a chance with me trying to work out how I was going to drive these that I'd mess it up. I wasn't quite sure how I was going to drive this clockwork. We'll look when we get to the bench over there, and that I might mess it up, so I better have a spare. And so that's why I got this. Now, as much as I do like this mechanism, it's skeletonized and it's nice and big, so it's easier to work with. You've got just a AA battery sat over there running a quartz movement, and that ticks along. And if you look carefully, you can see, if I bring it up, you can see how the gears are slowly, every second, the quartz movement is flicking over a small stepper motor, if you will, and driving the gears to drive the time. However, with my little bit of experience with watches and clocks, I also know that this kind of display has a few downsides. The fact that you've got this gold colored arms and your numbers or indices are in gold, this can sometimes be very difficult to see, and you can probably realize that just in this camera, depending on where the light falls, these can almost disappear from view. And the second hand is not a second hand on the main dial. You've got a sub dial with that second hand. That's still a reasonable size. Also, all the indices aren't marked out. And that's not the end of the world. But I have found another smaller dial which I may use in my final project. As I said, there's a bit of prototyping. Right, so that's the background behind finding this one. Let's go and look at the one that's being driven by the Arduino. Okay, let me do a quick bit of freehand because I say it's going to be difficult to talk to you with this kind of ticking or noise going on, and I'll explain the reason for that. I've got it here. There is a stepper motor driving this, which you'll see. Here is the actual Arduino. Now, what I want you to note, the important things before I turn this off, is if you see this, you can see that the seconds on the analog hand in the background are obviously in sync. That was obviously the whole aim of this. And it has been running for almost one day. It has not gone out of alignment. And now look up, when it hits that indice, bang, it's spot on. And that was one of my fears and challenges, was would I be able to drive this mechanism and keep it hitting the marks? And there have been a few challenges with being able to do that. So as you'll see, it'll go around and it's hitting the marks and it's in sync with the Arduino display. So I just want to show you that first off, that at least I managed to achieve that. This is being driven from my Rubidium standard, which is up over there. I've got this power pack, lithium iron phosphate power pack, acting as a UPS in case the power goes down, so at least I don't, if I'm testing it over a period of time. And then I've got the Rubidium standard coming into this old Philips function generator. I bought this cheap off eBay just so that I could have this project standing alone before I find a frequency divider, which I'm working on. So the frequency at 100 kilohertz is coming out of here, and that is what is driving the clock. And then I've got, obviously got a few more wires. I'm going to explain those once I actually switch this off and restart it, because I want to show you the startup process. And then there is an Adafruit driver or controller which controls a stepper motor. And in terms of timekeeping, so over here we've got the Fluke frequency counter, and you can see it's reading 10 microseconds. So now we're coming out for 24 hours. When I set this, I've got a procedure now where it automatically sees the atomic second pulse and starts my clock, so that I don't have to manually try and get this as close to zero as possible. It managed to get to within 5 microseconds. So it's only out by just about 5 microseconds in almost 24 hours. Now, if you recall my previous video, the Rubidium standard was losing about 15 microseconds. So I did a little adjustment to bring it far closer to 10 megahertz, and that certainly helped. It's helped by about threefold. So certainly this will keep time as long as it continues, potentially for hundreds of years. It would maintain time within 1 second. Righty-ho, so let me stop this from running. As I say, for me, the main test that I was trying to see over this 24 hours when I left yesterday and I finally got this running, was to make sure that the analog clock was still hitting the mark in sync, for one, in sync with what was happening on the digital display here, and that there was no creep in the stepper motor, so that it was hitting the indices exactly as it should. And as you can see, again, if I bring in a little bit closer to maintain the seconds, you can see how it's hitting the marks spot on. And when I say spot on, so I literally even have a fine adjustment, which I'm going to show you now, to line that second hand up precisely on the indices, and it's managing to hold correct. But I say, not without a fair bit of work getting there. So let me come out. I'm going to hit the reset button. And as it boots up, it does I get it to do a quick step to show me that it is talking to the clock. So it takes a second hand one step forward and one step back. Inside this clock, there is a little quartz movement. So there's a quartz movement. I've taken out, no, I haven't. Okay, so what I wanted to show you, it's sitting here in a case which I've split. I'm going to show you at some point during this video, show you some inserts. I took this clock, most of it apart on my desk near my computer, because that's where I can obviously code and program the Arduino. And that's where I've done most of my testing. But I was able to take things apart and then try and see mechanically how I could get this to run. But this literally is the little case which sits in there. It goes together like this. So there's an opening in the top where one of the gears is poking down in here and is driven by that gear over there. So the battery is on this side. The two wires come out to the battery. And perhaps the most eloquent way of running this would have been to actually to drive this stepper motor directly from the Arduino. There are a few challenges with that, and it's something I'm still going to look at for the other clock I've got, because the other one is going to be a bit more difficult to drive from a stepper motor. But doing that, for one, you're not just sending a positive pulse to this and then turning the little gear. You've got to send a pulse which is alternating positive and negative. It's an AC pulse basically to drive this little gear. So this little gear that you can see sitting down there, let me show you, it's basically floating. It's floating very lightly. As I pull this out, I just want to show you, I'm going to move it with my hands. So you can see there's very little pressure on there. And I'm showing you that because that's quite the opposite to what I'm doing, which is to say, something I need to be perhaps trying to improve on in the next prototype. It floats very lightly. And if I pull this out, you can see it's not even held in there. It's literally just the magnetism from this coil. It's, well, I say the coil, there's a magnet on the base of this gear, which is helping it float there very lightly so that it can be flipped around 180 degrees every second. So just, it's got, it's two steps. It's a stepper motor with basically just two steps. 180, 180, and that's how the seconds are ticking around. But the challenge of driving this is, for one, obviously sending that pulse. That's not a huge thing, but you need to be wary that when you're sending that pulse, you energize the coil, you've got a flux around here, and then that flux collapses when you remove the energy, and that sends it back. And you can end up damaging, particularly if something like an Arduino, if you send a pulse back through your digital inputs or your analog inputs, you could potentially damage or fry your Arduino or those IO pins. So I decided to take the approach of using a stepper motor. What you also need to do, you need to cut some of the tracks so that you separate out when you do start driving this. You need to, it's got some fine wires which are coming to the PCB. And if you kind of want to maintain this, you have to carefully cut some tracks so that you separate out the IC and the crystal oscillator so that you're only driving the coil. But anyway, that is something I still may end up doing. What I did, I did a fair hunt looking for step motors. Well, I first started looking at servos, and servos have their downsides. If you get a servo which can do a full rotation, many servos can only move a certain number of degrees, and they've got a switch which tells them where they are and they can come back. You do get servos which don't have that switch, but they potentially not that precise. So I went about looking on Adafruit, and I saw they had some nice stepper motors there, and they had some nice boards to drive them as well. But unfortunately, they didn't have the stepper motor in stock that they had on their site, but they did have the controller board. So I quickly placed the order, because this is obviously when COVID, the whole virus thing was happening, and shipping, certain things are going out of stock and shipping delays are all happening. So I quickly went and ordered a few of the driver boards and then shot over to Amazon to try and find that same stepper motor. And I, from the pictures, not looking too closely at the specs, right? I was a bit naughty because I was in a rush. At the end of the day, didn't want to miss out on something which is going to go out of stock. I quickly ordered the stepper motor off Amazon. It's actually slightly smaller than the one they had on Adafruit. It's also a 200 steps. That's why I thought it was the same thing. It's 200 steps, same one on Adafruit. The one on Adafruit is driven by 12 volts. It uses about, if I remember correctly, 350 or 60 milliamp. This one happens to be just over 600 milliamp, but it is driven at 3.8 volts. Now, that kind of was a bit of a whoopsie, because the Adafruit one was 12 versus 3.8. The little driver board I got could only drive motors read properly from 4.5 volts and up to 12 volts or over 12 volts. But as it so happened, that little mistake was kind of a blessing in disguise, with some caveats, because at 3.8 volts, it's not too far off. I could either perhaps drive, there's the 5 volt output from the Arduino. Now that's obviously overdriving it. So I used the 3.3 volts. So I'm driving the stepper motor, which is in the back of this clock, from the 3.3 volts. Now I could long-term have some issues because I'm not driving it at the right voltage. Also, there's a fair bit of current draw coming through this. And let me just explain the few whoopsies I had. Because I've got the motor directly connected, so let me just show you. I'm talking about it, I have to be a bit careful. I'm gonna put this upright. So that is where I've got the stepper motor. Now this is a smaller stepper motor than the one I've been showing you. This one you can see is a bit larger. I think this one's got more torque, it uses more current. So I used a smaller one there. I mounted it carefully, not without a few challenges, through the acrylic. Initially when I screwed the holes, and again I'll insert some pictures here, I drilled some holes carefully. I had to countersink the little the small bolts, because they would have hit some of the workings inside, and also they were fairly short, so I needed them countersunk so I had enough thread to go into the mounting holes on this. And I drilled them, I estimated where they should be, I didn't double check it, and I drilled them out all very nicely, but I was a couple of millimeters out, and so I had to do a little bit of MacGyvering with the drill to kind of slot the holes, which again worked out because it allowed me a little bit of slop. You're not going to see it easily from, because I've got the clock closed up, but I'll insert a picture. What I've done, I've got the shaft coming through, and I put a piece of, and it's not rubber, it's actually kind of a softer plastic on the shaft, and that has just got friction against the gear to drive it. So before we go into the challenges of doing that, let me first tell you about frying some of my Arduino Dues. Right, and the reason I'm going into this detail, which of course may be boring for some, is that, you know, perhaps someone can learn from my mistakes. But again, sometimes making mistakes can make you far wiser in building a more robust project, because you've realized what can go awry. So the reason I potentially fried, I know I fried one, and I think one which I thought was fried recovered, was that because I'm driving, being a little bit naughty and taking a chance, instead of providing a separate power supply to the stepper motor, because you have the opportunity on that little controller board, which is on the side here, you can have an external power supply running it for multiple reasons. Either you don't have enough current and voltage from the Arduino, also potentially there's noise from the stepper motor, which might upset if you try to look at RF or clock signals, that could be an issue. But obviously it's convenient if I can just have one power source going in here, which is driving the Arduino and the stepper motor. The maximum current that you can have, as I recall, going through the USB is 500 milliamp, but through the DC barrel or input over here, it's 800 milliamp. Now that stepper motor, I'm not driving it at the full voltage, but potentially, and I saw at least somewhere between 400 and 500 milliamps being drawn. And I've taken the chance to drive it through here. Now I know I can feel that on where the power regulators are on the Arduino board, it's certainly running a little warmer, but of course it's convenient. So I've got to see long-term whether that's going to work. But during my testing, while I'm writing code and trying to get the stepper motor to work in harmony with this, I'm having to unplug the DC barrel, disconnect the motor but with one of these wires, then plug in the USB so that I'm not driving the motor through the USB power. And at some point, I didn't get the sequence right. I left things plugged in here. I plugged in the USB and I fried one of the boards. Now, I fried one of them. These have obviously got two USB ports, but believe it or not, and I hadn't realized this, these Arduino Duos do have a resettable fuse. So they do have some overcurrent protection. So certainly one of these, when I unplugged it, I tried to, you can obviously program through the other port that I saw, I was able to address it and it did seem to come back, but I've definitely fried one from that mistake by driving too much current, I think, through this port. That's what I believe anyway. So that was one of the challenges. The other challenge was, when I initially got the stepper motor working, I had a separate piece of code, I wasn't using my clock, I was just trying to get the seconds to see whether it would drive the second hand on the clock there and hit all the indices correctly. Because even though this is a 200 step motor, obviously I only need 60 steps, right, for 60 seconds. If I only had 60 steps and there was any slop or that this wasn't moving accurately enough, I probably wouldn't hit those indices. Having higher resolution, more steps, provides me with a bit of wriggle room to then adjust so I'm hitting all the marks around the second hand. You do get other cheaper stepper motors. For instance, you can buy a whole box of these with controller boards off Amazon, and these can do 2,000 steps or over 2,000 steps per revolution. So there's a lot of control, but potentially they might still have their own issues in terms of stopping exactly where you want them. They might not be linear in their control. And that was my concern even doing this, you know, would I have enough control? And I found that fortunately I did. But that mechanical connection that I've got, where I'm not using a gear, I've merely got a piece of softer plastic on the shaft, which is pushing up against the gear where that very nice magnetic gear from the quartz movement is lightly floating and they're meshing together lightly. I'm now applying even though it's light, I'm applying light pressure against that gear. And it is sitting obviously with some pinions or on an axle. And that pressure over time might not hold out. It might wear prematurely or something like that. I'm hoping that because I've chosen this fairly robust mechanical, because they're big gears, that's not the case. But that's certainly a risk I face. And I say, I'm going to certainly, when I move to putting a stepper motor on the more pristine quartz movement, I may look at actually mounting a gear on the end of the stepper motor. But that was one of the challenges. So then the other challenge came that when I all hooked this up and I put the code for the stepper motor in with my clock, as soon as my clock started and wanted to drive the stepper motor to show the seconds, the whole Arduino froze, the code froze. It just stopped working. And I couldn't understand why. And it took a fair bit of troubleshooting. But ultimately, what I found was that I've got an interrupt, obviously calling, looking at the clock pulses coming into here. And I was trying to then, when that came in and it reached the number of counts to advance by a second, I was then trying to call a subroutine, a void, basically to then run the stepper motor through 1 second. But those were so close together that I think the hardware, the reading of the digital port for the incoming clock pulse, and then trying to send a signal out through digital outputs to drive the motor were so close that they were tripping each other up, so I had to separate them out. Now, during that process, something interesting happened. I had a fair bit of code which was being called by the interrupt, which is a bit naughty because you want your interrupt to happen very quickly and without disruption so that it can go away and do what it needs to do. And part of the reason that I was not able to run this at higher frequencies, at about 300, 400 kilohertz, this would not read the clock pulse properly, was because I had that code in there. And I went through a process of removing that, just updating a variable, and then moving the stepper motor control out somewhere else. And then I found I could run this at 740 kilohertz. So there certainly was a whoopsie or a little mistake that I was doing in my code. I suspected as much. But however, when I did that, and I took that code out and then and ran it in another subroutine from the main loop, it was not running fast enough. This wasn't keeping proper time. So I actually had to move some code back to where the interrupt was calling it. And again, I'm not showing you my code at this point in time. I'm kind of talking it in free air because I want to get it right before I actually go through and show you what I've done. I say a fair bit of work in there. The other interesting challenge I found, the one thing I thought, because I had this the stepper motor hooked up to a step at one point, I thought, is that it creating noise? So I did drive the stepper motor from a separate power supply and had this running off its own power supply. And I saw that the stepper motor was drawing, let's say, somewhere between 300 and 500 milliamps. And I thought, okay, so is that generating noise that was stopping the code from running? And it wasn't the case. I still had the problem. At that point in time, I hadn't tweaked that I had to really separate out the call to the stepper motor in my code. But then I realized that, okay, well, there's this current that's running, even when I'm not sending a command to this to turn the stepper motor. And that's fairly obvious. Most stepper motors, what happens is when you start talking to them, you then have a constant control or current going to them to hold the motor in place. So you'd send a command to either step it so many steps one way or the other way, and then it is held in place by the energized coils in here. And this has got two coils, so you've got four sets of wires going into this, two per coil. And that's how it controls the stepping. But those are energized to hold this in place. I mean, so much so that you cannot twist it because there's so much torque with it being held in place. I thought, now, is there a way to de-energize it? I did some research, yes. Basically, after I send the command to step this through 1 second, I then go and send a command to drive the digital outputs low. That then de-energizes the stepper motor. So that was great because I thought, cool, that also saves the current which is being drawn by this project. You know, it only uses current for a split second when this has been driven to the next second. I then de-energize it. But what I discovered was when I did that, when it was running, it wasn't hitting the indices properly. There was creep. So I'd hit 5 seconds fine, or it'd go right round, and it would kind of be hitting the marks or the indices, and then on the next minute when it is going round, it would then be stepping slightly past the indices. So 5 seconds wouldn't happen exactly cleanly on the 5 seconds, it would go past. And I was like, oh no, that was the one thing I feared. And I discovered it was because I was taking the energy away from this, and obviously because the rotor wasn't being held exactly tightly in place, or it was being re-energized and just slightly creeping perhaps, that was the problem. So I've had to maintain the coils being energized to keep everything in step, but it works. So let me show you the startup process of this project now. One of the challenges obviously is that potentially the second hand is not going to be starting in the right place. So if I draw you in right now to that second hand, you can see that it's not sitting exactly at the 60 second mark at the top there. It is slightly off. Now what I'm going to try and do is get that in shot and the Arduino. So what happens is when this boots, as I said, I'm going to reset it and just look at the second hand. So there you go. See, it takes a step forward and a step back. And I do that just to see that things are communicating when things start up. I then have got control where the up cursor button allows me to advance by a second. So if I hold that down, you can see it's advancing by a second step, and I can go back by a second step. But sometimes I might not necessarily perfectly line up with the actual indice or the marking. So I'll just show you as an example. If I go to that mark over there, because it's easier to line up on a straight indice rather than a number, I have then also built in where I can take very small steps to actually get the second hand to line up. So as you can see there, I can take very small steps to, if you like, calibrate or align my second hand with the indices. So when I start off, I do a coarse second adjustment. I take it up to the 60, and as you can see, if you can see that, it's actually not lining up properly now. And I just go tap, 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 forward, back, get it lined up as best I can. I've got the camera in front of me, so it's difficult to see, but at least now I've got that fine adjustment. Then the next step is when I push the select, it brings me to the time and I can adjust the time. Now I've made some improvements here. Previously I had only the up and down operating. I think the up did the minutes and the down did the hours. Now I can go backwards and forwards instead of going right through if I miss the time. So I can adjust the hours up and down. I can adjust the minutes up and down. And then the next thing is to start this, but to start it perfectly in sync with an atomic second. Now initially what I was doing was I'd be looking at a clock, I'd get the time set up. What I obviously need to do is also then set the analog hands on the clock, right? So I set the analog hands and I have to choose a time, because I haven't got individual markings between all the minutes. So I've only got indices at the five minute marks. I wait until I'm literally at one of these marks, and even like for instance the 9 is there just out of view, but there's no straight line, so it's far easier to line up with this indice for instance. So I've lined that up, I get the seconds lined up, and then when the time comes I need to push the start button as close to the atomic second as possible. But of course there's no ways me staring at a clock changing I'm going to do that. So in my first bit of code I'd start it, and then in the next mode I would be able to adjust by 10 microseconds. I could pull the time in, and I'd need an oscilloscope, right? I'd have an oscilloscope. I showed you this in a previous video where I'd slowly line up I've got the one pulse per second coming from a GPS satellite through the GPS discipline oscillator. I would use that and I'd then pull in that I've got a 1 second pulse coming out of here, so I know exactly this precise 1 second pulse coming out here, and I use that to line up the two. So at least I start this off as close to the atomic 1 second as possible. But what I've done since then is I've added some input to read the atomic one pulse second. So although this, I can't just push a button and wait and it starts at the right time, I've got a full second where I can, when the clock hits 59 seconds, right? So let's say we're at 105 and 4 minutes and 59 seconds. As soon as it hits 59, I push the start button. This doesn't start until it sees the clock pulse going high from the atomic second. And when it sees that going high, then it starts my Arduino. So it's still not exactly perfect. I could add an external clock to this and set this totally automatically, but I don't want that complication in here. I want to keep it as simple as possible. I think there are ways I can improve on what I'm doing now, but right now, at least I'm not juggling with an oscilloscope. As soon as I push this, it'll align itself to an atomic 1 second. So let's just see that. I'm going to take you back and have a look at the Fluke frequency counter. So as I push this, bang, the clock will start ticking. There you go. And you see it took a pause, and that's because it was waiting for the atomic 1 second. So you can see it started ticking, and the seconds in the background on the analog clock start ticking. and I just want to show you. And this is a fluke. I don't normally get it this close. So there is the fluke frequency count and what it's doing. I've got two signals coming in and it's comparing the time difference between the atomic second and my clock. And you can see I'm within nanoseconds. Now it is rare for me to get it that close because I've only got a resolution. The finest resolution is about 10 microseconds because the frequency I'm running it at, I can be as much as close to 10 microseconds out. Normally I'm within roughly 5 microseconds. It starts and it syncs up. But here in this case, I'm literally just pushing it and having the atomic clock pulse then actually start my clock. I'm within nanoseconds of the atomic 1 second. Right, so next let me give you an update on the College Power Supply project. Again, one of those, it hasn't been sitting idle in the background. Ideally it needs my undivided attention, but I'm unable to give it my undivided attention. So I grab snippets of time, and when I feel I get to a point where there's something worth filming, I'll obviously do that. But what happened was, when I brought this out and started working on it again, the software that I was using for the circuit layout and the PCB design went through an update. It was at RS Components, I think Design Spark, if I remember correctly. It just wasn't working on my PC. It was crashing. And at end of the day, I was wasting time trying to troubleshoot that. And I threw it out and I installed KiCad. And perhaps that's what I should have done from the start, was use something like KiCad. So I had to then teach myself the basics of KiCad to then go and reinsert my circuit design for the College Power Supply. And then obviously I've now at the point, I've done that, so I've got this in KiCad. I'm now at the point where I'm just trying to get my components laid out. And of course I did this many years ago on a very basic PCB design CAD program. KiCad is way more advanced, and I'm now even considering doing it on a double layer board. I was thinking just doing single layer board, and I thought, no, hang on, got the opportunity. I can obviously send it to PCBWay and get a double layer board for cheap. It obviously makes it easier with the layout because you've got it's less tricky in terms of your tracks if you're using both sides of the PCB. And this is something I say when I get to that point that I've got that done, I'll explain that learning process, because it's the first time I've done this for many years, and certainly I've not done a double-sided PCB, never mind a multi-layered PCB, but we'll see how that turns out. Now what happened while I was doing this, I also came across a couple of errors which might explain some of the issues I was having with the feedback loop with the op amp. That was where we left off on this project. So for one, there were some circuit changes. On this design, you'll see I had a line. I thought I'd found a mistake, and I did a line down here. So that was the one change to my circuit. I connected this Zener diode to the negative rail down here. And you can see I've got this crossed out. I had a connection over here. And the reason for that was when I was measuring the values, trying to find out where these wires were going, the resistor over here is only, and I forget whether it's a 0.4 and it's a 0.2 ohm. I cannot read it, the print is so small, but it's a very small value, less than an ohm. So when you're doing the measurement, you've got that in your test leads basically. So that was the problem, why I was taking a measurement and not realizing I was on the wrong side of this resistor in terms of this connection. So that was the one mistake. And then the other one, which I think was the most critical, was that you've got components which are obviously sitting on the, which have to be on the heatsink. So your transistors or your FET. So if we go and have a look, and if you've been following this project long enough, you'll remember that I obviously did some testing with heat dissipation, all that kind of thing. This is where we're up when I did the final testing. And I've obviously got the transistors, the power transistors or the FETs connected to this, but that is all. And then I realized something when I took a closer look at my College Power Supply. If we look down there, and I'm not sure whether you'll be able to see it, let me try and bring you in. Can you see it? There is a resistor. If I bring some more light onto this, you can see there is a resistor on the back of there. Besides, if I flip this other upside down, which I won't do now, you've got the other transistor and there is a diode. So let me just bring you back to the diagram. So that's why I've gone and circled these components over here. These are all the components which are sitting on the heatsink on my original college power supply. I only had the two transistors, there's a resistor, and there's a diode. And my thinking is, and I'm sure someone will correct me if I'm wrong, but these are placed right on these components because of the way they are operating and having longer lead lengths. If these are sitting on your PCB and you've got these long leads going to them, you then got a long lead length, which means things like inductance and all kinds of things could be going wrong and upsetting the potential feedback loop. And that is where I think I had my problem. So I've now realized that. So in the PCB design, I'm obviously going to have points where I then have leads. So basically where I put the connection points over here, this is where I'll have three leads going off to the heat sink. And then these will all be connected up like they are on my original college power supply. So I think I've now found the key mistake. But I say that hopefully will happen. I'm going to take, again, try and take some days and give myself some undivided attention where I just finish the component layout and then I can send it up to PCBWay. Again, as I might have mentioned in the start of this video, I'm not going to tell them when I do that because I don't want to receive any special treatment, like in terms of special service, how quickly they turn it around. I want to see how long it's going to turn around and the quality of the PCB I get back from PCBWay.
Righty-ho, so if you got to this point, thank you very much. I hope that's been of interest. And again, if you're watching my videos and getting frustrated because there's a lot of chit-chat, then don't watch my videos. Unsubscribe. There are other channels where people are far more concise and get it in and out, like Instant Coffee. Go and watch those channels. Don't watch mine. But if you are here still, and particularly, I just want to also talk about my patrons and say thanks very much to my patrons. I don't have a lot of them. It's not something I promote that much. And perhaps a lot of people out there kind of don't see the value in supporting me via Patreon. But let me just tell you about what they do and potential benefits that they will get. For one, my patrons will get to see my videos at least several hours, if not a day, ahead of when I release them. So I allow them at least, say, anywhere between 12 and 24 hours of pre-release. They get to see it ahead of time. What's the advantage of that? The one is, let's say, for instance, I'm talking about something like a special deal on finding a Regal at a cheaper price, or something, some other device where potentially, if I mention it, those items might sell out quickly. If you're a patron and you watch the video and it's something that you might be interested in, you're gonna have first digs at that before it gets released to the masses. So that's the one thing. Also, then again, I'm going to, as I've mentioned, when I do the video on the watches, the giveaway watch is going to go to one of my patrons. And there'll be other videos where my patrons receive priority in terms of the giveaways. And it's because they are going that extra little bit to support me. People don't have to support me with my videos. I'm very fortunate. I do look after myself, although I still do want to earn a living from what I do. And hence, that's why I have a sponsor. But I appreciate the people who do that extra bit. Those patrons, right? I'm not necessarily always going to have a sponsor to pay the bills. And there are bills to be paid. But the small amount of money I receive from my patrons actually pays for my internet access and my electricity bill and my insurance for the studio. So their small contribution literally keeps the lights on in my studio and the internet running. And that's a big thing, and I really do appreciate it. But anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.